गुरुदेवो महेश्वरा गुरु
गुरु
साक्षात
साक्षात
परम ब्रह्म
ब्रह्म
तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः। आज
हाँ
गुरु पूर्णिमा के शुभ अवसर पर हमारे बीच हाँ
हाँ हेलो
सर
यस
सर
सर यस सर
आवाज आ ठीक।
हाँ आ रही आवाज आ रही है।
हाँ सर हम लोग कार्यक्रम
आज गुरु पूर्णिमा के शुभ अवसर पर हमारे बीच
उपस्थित
उपस्थित आयुर्वेद जगत के शल्य तंत्र के दो प्रबुद्ध गुरुओं के गुरु डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर मनोरंजन साहू सर, प्रोफेसर के ठकराल सर, पूरे भारतवर्ष के विभिन्न प्रदेशों से जुड़े हुए इस वेब कॉन्फ्रेंस में उपस्थित प्राध्यापक बंधु, छात्र एवं छात्राओं, आप सभी का मैं डॉक्टर लोकेश, आयुर्वेद टीचर्स एसोसिएशन ऑफ इंडिया मध्य प्रदेश इकाई के महासचिव के नाते स्वागत, वंदन और अभिनंदन करता हूँ। जैसा कि पूर्व के सेमिनार अपने वेब कॉन्फ्रेंस में विषय रखा गया था कि इस प्लेटफॉर्म का उपयोग पीयूष जी सबको म्यूट कर दीजिए। पीयूष जी इस प्लेटफॉर्म का उपयोग अपने आयुर्वेद जगत के प्रबुद्ध जो आचार्य हैं, जो गुरु हैं, उनकी ज्ञान गंगा, उनकी ज्ञान सिंधु से कुछ बूंदे निकालकर आज के समय में हम सभी तक पहुंचाना, चाहे वो आयुर्वेद के शिक्षक हो, आयुर्वेद का स्नातक या मुख्य रूप से स्नातकोत्तर का छात्र हो, वहां तक पहुंचाना है। इस क्रम में आज शल्य तंत्र विषय के ऊपर ये वेब कॉन्फ्रेंस आयोजित की गई है। आशा है कि हम सभी इस विषय के जो आप्त आचार्य हैं उनके ज्ञान से हम सभी लाभान्वित होंगे। आज के इस वेब कॉन्फ्रेंस को मूर्त रूप देने में सबसे बड़ा योगदान हमारे गुरु प्रोफेसर सुश्रुत कन्नौजिया सर, प्रोफेसर और एचओडी गवर्नमेंट आयुर्वेदिक कॉलेज ग्वालियर का रहा है। साथ में आज के कोऑर्डिनेटर मॉडरेटर डॉक्टर दिवाकर पटेल जी, एचओडी एंड एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर गवर्नमेंट आयुर्वेदिक कॉलेज उज्जैन का भी है। भारतीय संस्कृति की परंपराओं के अनुरूप आज के इस वेब कॉन्फ्रेंस का उद्घाटन प्रभु भगवान धन्वंतरी की वंदना से प्रारंभ किया जाता है। मैं डॉक्टर रवि कुमार श्रीवास्तव जी से निवेदन करूंगा कि भगवान धन्वंतरी की वंदना से कार्यक्रम को प्रारंभ किया जाए। श्रीवास्तव जी से दो शब्द आज के कार्यक्रम के विषय में रखने के लिए निवेदन करता हूँ।
जय अरविंद। परम श्रद्धेय प्रोफेसर मनोरंजन सर और प्रोफेसर के ठकराल सर, इस मंच पे आप जैसे तज्ञ विद्वानों को हम लोग पाके और आज विशेषतः गुरु पूर्णिमा के अवसर पे आप लोगों के दर्शन मात्र से हम लोगों के कृतार्थ हुए हैं, इसके लिए हम लोग आपके चरण में वंदन करते हुए इस मंच पे आप लोगों का स्वागत करते हैं। जो श्रोतागण हैं उनका स्वागत करते हैं। आज भारतीय जीवन शैली के दृष्टिकोण से आयुर्वेद हमारे उसके एक बहुत बड़े आयाम धन्वंतरी संप्रदाय का प्रतिनिधित्व करने वाले आज श्रेष्ठ जन सब विद्य जन यहाँ पे एकत्रित हुए हैं, जो सुश्रुत संप्रदाय और खासकर शल्य चिकित्सा के प्रतीक हैं, ऐसे तज्ञ विद्वानों को सभी का यहाँ पर स्वागत है। ये विषय मूलतः हमारे भारत में आयुर्वेद के उद्भव के साथ हुआ है और आदि काल से इसको यूनानी काल में, अरबी में और जो पश्चिमी काल है खासकर 1200 ईसा पूर्व और 1500 जो आधुनिक काल आया है, तो कहीं हम अगर इसकी प्रासंगिकता देखते हैं तो अथर्ववेद में छत जो हमारा आयुर्वेद का शाश्वत ज्ञान है, जो अथर्ववेद से पांचवी वेद के रूप में जाना जाता है, छत विद्युर्धि व्रण और अस्थियों का जोड़ना, कटे हुए अंग को ठीक करना, पृथक पृथक मांस मज्जाओं को स्वस्थ करने वाली औषधि के बारे में वर्णन किया गया है और खासकर बुद्ध काल के समय में जीवक चिकित्सक के रूप में उनके द्वारा बड़े बड़े शल्य कर्म ऐसा वर्णन किया गया है और ऐसे कई उदाहरण शास्त्रोक्त हमें मिलते हैं कि शल्य क्रिया जो हमारे शास्त्र में आयुर्वेद में विद्यमान थी, जैसे दधीच के सिर को हटा के उसकी जगह घोड़े के सिर का प्रत्यारोपण, यज्ञ के कटे सिर को पुनः संधान करना, स्राव का कुष्ठ रोग दूर करके उसे दीर्घायु प्रदान करना, इत्यादि ऐसे कई उदाहरण हैं जो आचार्य सुश्रुत के सुश्रुत काल में उसके उन काल के ऐसा हमें अपने वेदों में देखने है। उसी की परंपरा में आप दोनों विद्यजन जो यहाँ पे उपस्थित हुए, गुरु हमारे गुरुओं के गुरु हैं, आपके द्वारा निश्चित रूप से इस मंच पे जो भी ज्ञान दिया जाएगा वो समुद्र में वो बूंदों के समान होगा, जो निश्चित हम और हमारे टीचर संवर्ग के लोग और छात्र छात्राएं जो जुड़े हैं उससे लाभान्वित होंगे। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ अपनी मैं वाणी को समाप्त रखते हुए आप लोगों से, आप लोगों को यहाँ इस मंच पे आए इसका धन्यवाद देते हुए मैं इस कार्यक्रम को आगे प्रस्तुत करने के लिए आपसे अनुरोध करता हूँ। कृपया हम लोगों को
सर्वप्रथम द्वि गुरुओं को सादर चरण वंदन। सूचकस्य वाचको दर्शक तथा शिक्षको बोधक शिष्यो सड़ते गुरु स्मृता। सभी गुरुओं को प्रणाम। आज बहुत ही हर्ष एवं प्रसन्नता का विषय है कि हम सभी के बीच में आयुर्वेद की दो प्रसिद्ध आचार उपस्थित हैं जो कि आचार्य सुश्रुत के अंश कहे जाते हैं। आज हम सभी को दोनों आचार्यों का मार्गदर्शन एवं अनुभव सुनने को मिलेगा। वर्तमान समय में आयुर्वेद में सुश्रुत संहिता का ज्ञान ग्रहण किस पद्धति से सरल सुदृढ़ प्राप्त हो सके, ऐसा हर स्नातक हम सभी स्नातक स्नातक दिशा के बारे में है क्योंकि अनुभव रूपी ज्ञान के प्रकाश से विषय की सरलता रूपी ज्ञान प्राप्त होगा। आदरणीय डॉक्टर मनोरंजन साहू सर जो कि आयुर्वेद के प्रख्यात शल्य चिकित्सक हैं, डॉक्टर आप पूर्व में चिकित्सा विज्ञान संस्थान बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी में अधिष्ठाता के पद को सुशोभित किया है, आपने आयुर्वेद में एमडी पीएचडी की डिग्री प्राप्त की है, आपने दुष्टवर्ण चिकित्सा डायबिटिक अल्सर हेतु बायोडिग्रेडेबल वुंड हीलिंग पैचेस थ्रू आयुर्वेदिक मेडिसिन का उपयोग एवं अनुसंधान किया है, आपने बीएचयू आईएमएस मतलब आईएमएस बीएचयू को 1993 में ज्वाइन किया था और उसके पश्चात निरंतर वहीं पर कार्यरत विभिन्न पदों को सुशोभित करते हुए आपने कार्य किया है। तत्पश्चात आपने विषय यहां पर विभिन्न पदों को सुशोभित किया। आपको सर्वप्रथम राष्ट्रीय छात्र चिकित्सा का नोडल अधिकारी बनाया, भारत शासन द्वारा आपको सर्वप्रथम राष्ट्रीय छात्र चिकित्सा का नोडल अधिकारी बनाया गया था। आपने अनेक नेशनल इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंसेस में अपने लेक्चर्स दिए हैं और आयुर्वेदिक छात्र विधि मेथड्स को पूरे विश्व में अच्छे तरीके से किस रिसर्च के मेथड से उसको प्रेजेंट किया है आपने, और गुदागत रोगों की एक नई इकाई को डेवलप किया है जिनमें से सबसे बेस्ट टेक्निक्स जो मुझे मैं भी ज्ञान आपसे ग्रहण किया हूं वो है बिंदु मेथड। बिंदु मेथड में बहुत ही एक क्लासिकल टेक्स्ट को ध्यान रखते हुए आपने वो उसको डेवलप किया और पूरे देश में उस मेथड को हर साल चिकित्सा आयुर्वेद का अपना रहा है। ऐसे गुरुवर को आज मौका मिलेगा सुनने के लिए। इसी प्रकार से हमारे बीच में डॉक्टर ठकराल सर हैं, डॉक्टर के ठकराल सर, आदरणीय प्रोफेसर के ठकराल सर हैं। आप भी आयुर्वेद के प्रख्यात शल्य चिकित्सक हैं। आपने सुश्रुत संहिता का सरल ढंग से लिपिबद्ध कर सुश्रुत संहिता लिखी है। आपका स्नातक स्टेट आयुर्वेदिक कॉलेज लखनऊ से 1964 में और स्नातकोत्तर IIMS BHU से 1968 में हुआ है। आप उत्तर प्रदेश शासन के विभिन्न आयुर्वेदिक कॉलेजों में विभिन्न पदों को सुशोभित किया है। आप अधिष्ठाता के पद में भी कार्य किया है। आपने उत्तर प्रदेश शासन के यूनानी आयुर्वेद यूनानी बोर्ड के संचालक का भी दायित्व निर्वहन किया है। ऐसे द्वितीय आचार्यों को आज हमारे बीच सुनने को मिलेगा। सर्वप्रथम मैं मनोरंजन साहू सर से निवेदन करूंगा कि आज हम सभी के बीच में उपस्थित हैं और हमारे जो भी पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैं, जो स्नातक स्नातकोत्तर छात्र छात्राएं हैं, आपको सुनेंगे जो शल्य चिकित्सा शल्य शास्त्र के कठिनता और उसकी सरलता को किस ढंग से ग्रहण किया जा सके उसका दर्शन लाभ मिलेगा, सुनने को मौका मिलेगा। आदरणीय साहू सर से निवेदन करूंगा कि अपना ज्ञान प्रदान करें।
बहुत धन्यवाद दिवाकर जी। आज एक संयोग है कि आज गुरु पूर्णिमा है। इस गुरु पूर्णिमा के पावन अवसर पर सभी गुरुओं को मेरी हार्दिक बधाइयां। मुझे बहुत खुशी है कि आज इस प्रोग्राम में प्रोफेसर के ठाकराल जो मेरे ज्येष्ठ हैं और मेरे गुरु तुल्य हैं उनको भी मेरा प्रणाम। डॉक्टर ठाकराल मेरा प्रणाम स्वीकार करें आप। बहुत अच्छा लगा आपके आज गुरु पूर्णिमा के दिन आपको मुझे आपके इस प्रोग्राम में आपके आपसे मुलाकात होकर के। सबसे पहले आज एक ऐसे विषय पर बात हम लोग करने जा रहे हैं कि जो थोड़ी सी आपने जिसको हम रेगुलर टीचिंग एक्टिविटीज कहते हैं उससे थोड़ी डाइवर्सिफाइड फील्ड है। टीचिंग लर्निंग प्रोसेस के बारे में आज हमें डिस्कस करने के लिए या आपके साथ जो भी संभव हो सके शेयर करने के लिए मैं कोशिश करूंगा। ज्यादातर मेरी जो प्रेजेंटेशन है वो राधर मैं ये कहूंगा कि मेरी अपनी बहुत सारी चीजें जो टीचिंग लर्निंग प्रोसेस में मैंने अपने लाइफ में शेयर किया है या जो मैंने अनुभव किया है वही मैं शेयर करूंगा आपके साथ। मुझे वास्तव में आज बहुत इस पर्टिकुलर दिन पर जो है गुरु पूर्णिमा के दिन पर आज के ऐसा लग रहा है कि इन गुरुओं के सान्निध्य से सान्निध्य में रह करके मुझे शिक्षा मिली है, चाहे वो मेरी प्राइमरी एजुकेशन हो, चाहे इंटरमीडिएट एजुकेशन हो, चाहे हायर एजुकेशन हो, चाहे मैं ग्रेजुएशन में कल जब मैं पढ़ा हूँ उस समय बहुत सारे टीचर्स के सान्निध्य में आया हूँ। लेकिन ये वास्तव में बहुत कठिन है कि सभी टीचर्स के एक्टिविटीज नहीं याद रह जाते हैं, लेकिन कुछ टीचर्स हैं जो लाइफ में हर एक के साथ ऐसा होता है कि वो उनके मार्गदर्शक होते हैं, उनके एक रोल मॉडल होते हैं, उनको हमेशा याद रहता है और ज़्यादातर कार्य में उनको हम साथ देखते हैं या उनको हम स्मरण करते हैं नित्य। तो ऐसे मेरे साथ जीवन में बहुत सारे टीचर्स आए हुए हैं जो वास्तव में अपने पूरे जीवन को शिक्षा देने के लिए और कुछ डिलीवरेट करने के लिए अपने जीवन को लोगों ने व्यतीत किए हैं। वो बहुत आदर्श शिक्षक थे। आज ऐसे सभी शिक्षकों को मैं प्रणाम करता हूँ और मैं जो मेरी प्रेजेंटेशन है उसको मैं आपके साथ शेयर करूँगा और आगे का काम मैं कोशिश करूँगा। कहना है मेरी जो प्रेजेंटेशन है आपके साथ, कैन यू सी माय प्रेजेंटेशन? मेरा प्रेजेंटेशन विजिबल है?
यस सर, अभी नहीं स्क्रीन में आया सर, अभी इन स्टार्ट स्क्रीन शेयरिंग सर,
जस्ट ए मिनट।
यस सर, हो गया सर,
लेट मी मेक इट एज ए फुल स्क्रीन।
नो सर, अभी फुल स्क्रीन नहीं है सर।
लेट मी डू इट सर। मैं इस स्पीच में एक रिक्वेस्ट आप सबसे करूंगा, जो ऑर्गेनाइजर्स हैं उनको, कि जूम जो प्रेजेंटेशन प्लेटफॉर्म है
जी,
वो गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने कई बार उसको जो है अनशेप करके बैन किए हुए हैं। तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि हमारे पास ढेर सारे विकल्प हैं, तो उन विकल्पों में से किसी एक को आप चुने, जूम प्लेटफॉर्म शायद हमारे लिए ठीक नहीं। तो सो वी विल डिस्कस टुडे द टीचिंग मेथोडोलॉजी, व्हाट कैन वी, हाउ कैन वी कम्युनिकेट बेटर, यू सी, फॉर ए बेटर अंडरस्टैंडिंग, प्रोवाइडिंग एडिक्वेट नॉलेज टू द स्टूडेंट्स, दैट इज आवर मेन आइडिया ऑफ द टुडे डिस्कस। See, if you see our heritage, India has a rich tradition of learning and education right from the beginning. If you see that students from Europe, Eastern, especially in Eastern Europe, Middle East, and Eastern part of Asia, many countries, they used to come to India for their higher education. That was a dream for students, that they should come and learn in India. Like today we dream that this is a fascinating university for a student to join there. The same thing in earlier time, they spend a lot of time, even there, if you can imagine, you see, on those days there was no such communication. People used to come by walk. So thousands of kilometers, you see, coming from China to Vietnam, to the European country. So they come by sea, you see. So you can imagine how long they used to travel. And that was not sure that they will all join, they will get an opportunity to make a study in India. And especially the Indian university, like education, higher education center, like Taxila and Nalanda, they are most famous, though there are many other, but they are most prominent issues where there is a higher education system. And if you see that this system of education in India was prevailing, was a gurukul system. One such, you see, a method of education which was popular in ancient. We will talk more about this gurukul system of education. Now, if you see, this Gurukul system is an ancient Indian concept of education wherein the participants get knowledge by residing with the teachers as a part of their family, part of their family. Guru refers to teachers as master. So, where after a period of time, certain period of time, they used to come to a ashram, which are usually at a natural place. They are at a natural places, away from the locality, and the teachers, the gurus, they used to teach. They are the master. That's a comprehensive teaching. This is the objective of gurukul teaching, was self-control, character development. That is very important. Social awareness, personality development, intellectual development, spiritual development, and preservation of knowledge and culture. Most of you know aware that in ancient India, this education was primarily of two kinds. This is one is a पराविद्या एंड अपराविद्या. पराविद्या मीन्स टू इट्स ए हायर एजुकेशन. हायर एजुकेशन इन द सेंस वेयर एन इंडिविजुअल कनेक्ट द सुप्रीम नेचर, सुप्रीम पावर इज. सो दैट्स ए स्पिरिचुअल डेवलपमेंट. Whereas Aparavidya, they are primarily the lower education where we do learn so many things, you see, like maybe Jyotish, maybe medicine, maybe this agriculture, archery, so on and so on, whatever. These all Vedas, they all come under this Aparavidya, where their inferior knowledge rather called. Superior knowledge means the knowledge through which we communicate to the supreme power. The spiritual awareness, the spiritual development. So that was, so for that, both you see a Gurukul process of learning was done. Gurukul is center for comprehensive learning. It's not of only education, you see, but theoretical or reading books or chanting slokas. It is basically a complete development. That includes the various points which I have already told you. That's a self-control, character development, social awareness. This all comes in. This there are three group of people, students. They are there. Vasu, they are up to the age of 3 to 4 years. Rudra, they are up to the age of 36 years. And Aditya, after the age of 48 years, they remain. They become masters. So they are the different degree of education they get residing at Gurukul, and where the culture and discipline, they learn the culture and discipline of life. Students, that is another important aspect, that they live together with a good brotherhood, humanity, love and discipline. A center of comprehensive learning with respect to the elders, parents and teachers, they are compulsory. The discipline life in Gurukul was tremendous. It was a very disciplined life. They lived together. People, see, whatever the family they belong, see, they once they come to a Gurukul, their social, their caste, their whether they are son from son of a king or son of a other people, you see, that they do not differentiate. The Gurukul, they are not different. So they work together, they live together, the social aspect. The Gurukul education, you see, this at the time it was free and accessible to all. See, it was at times it has been mentioned that sutras are not permitted, but if you look many other texts, especially in Ayurveda, nobody has heard this other caste, you see, especially the Sudras. Sushrut has mentioned that Sudras are also permitted, provided they are suitable for this study. Therefore, if you see in true sense, it was free to everybody, and the society, I mean, it's a gift to the society by the teachers. The another important aspect, now the education is a state-owned, you see, mostly, we have a state-owned colleges, we have a state-owned schools, we have a state-owned, you see, universities. But earlier, it was the king and rulers had nothing to do with education directly. It was a private affair entirely by the teachers. They are supposed to find out who is suitable, who are not suitable. Teachers depend for their support, goodwill by the charity of the people. It was the duty of the people to give some kind of a gift to the teachers so that they can run their organization, their ashrams. Teachers were a highly honored class. They are more honored than kings at times, as we know that that a king is worshipped at the place where he is a king, but a learned man, a guru, is respected everywhere. So that was a very common things in our ancient India. the teachers behaved as a parent and the students and the, are also in their return they behave just like a member of the families. And house of teacher was a school or a college, the teachers and students, they live together with a relation was very cordial and friendly. So that was a kind of atmosphere which developed in group education. They remain, they stay, they work, they have a congenial atmosphere to learn. That is why in Indian culture, as we today we say that a special emphasis on the gurus, discipline and lessons. It's really an opportunity. It's a grace of God to get a real guru. If you get a real guru, you will get a Brahma. So if a person sincerely seeks, so God sees that he gets a real guru. So if you wish to, because gurus are, they provide you a path, they provide you, they guide you, they take you towards the guru. That was the type of a respect towards the guru. Gurukul education system, they are usually the teaching methodology was of, like today you see we have a lot of multimedia, say what we are doing today, we do not see each other, but we can communicate with each other. So on those days it was not there. So the mainly the teaching, the learning, the things, books are also very less, not there. There are things are there only by written on Tadapatra or some other means like the bark of trees, they are there. So they are mainly the learning process was communicated to Sravan, listening, Shruti. That was the best means of teaching, listening to the teachers. And Shravan was listening to the teachers from the leaf of the teacher. Knowledge was technically called, this was we called Shruti. That was heard not from a written language. So the students become attentive to listen to their gurus and they learn by listening. Once they learn by listening, then go for a manan. The reflection on what was listened to, manan, that implies that the people was to think out of himself the meaning of the lessons to him orally by his teacher. Means what he has listened, he tried to understand it. So that was the manan. Listening, then manan, then Nidhyasana. This constant, what we did, they try to realize it. So that is another step. The final step means first they listen, they realize, or usme usko atmasat kar. So that is probably to make it his or her own. So that's a process of learning what was there in those days. Primarily from the guru, they used to chant, read slokas, they read from, they listen from the gurus, they recite, they remember it, then they realize it. That's not the end of it. See, traveling was considered, was a part of this education system, and they moved from one place to another place to learn the things. The place of education was generally in the forest, which was far from the crowded area. The ancient rishis established the earliest school in ashrama in the forest. The system of Gurukul was in the knowledge, the home of the teacher, and regarded as a school. That's what I told you earlier. See, if you look to the higher education in ancient India, the higher education, the students were taught literary science, scientific and vocational education. Literary, scientific and vocational education. In literary education, the religions is one of the others. Teaching were also included on Vedas, beside Atharva Ved. All the Vedas were taught in the fundamental stone of education. The following subjects are mentioned in Jataka, that is during this Buddhist period, Jataka. And what is mentioned that medicine, thus Vasikarana, Kama Tantra, then Tantra Mantra, archery, elephant, then elephant taming, hunting, giving life to a dead, that is something, a supernatural teaching. They are especially during Buddha period, the knowledge of various animals also, bias of animals. So these are some of the areas we are also, I'm also coming that there are other areas also they used to taught, you see, during those days. These are, you can found, you see, in our ancient Indian education. The higher education system, only the higher studies are, they are mainly found, as I told you, in Takshila, Nalanda, and Varanasi also. The students from more than 16 years age are admitted in the university system, where the chief branches of the subjects were Vedas, Vedanta, Vyakaran, Ayurveda, then this crafts, military education, astronomy, agriculture, commerce, so cure of snake bites, etc. They are also there. They are also being taught in those days. Panini, the father of Vyakaran, Jivaka, the expert of surgical experts during Buddha's period, they are some of the product of Takshashila. Kautilya, the famous Arthashastra, they are also the higher education, came out from the higher education. That I already told you, the no caste distinction was there. Takshashila has been influenced also by Greeks also in those days. The Indian military teaching were there. Education in Ayurveda in ancient. See, these are, if you look this Ayurvedic education also in Ayurveda, is there a certain kind of a more prescribed, you see, they are more professional. And if you look to the Sushruta Samhita, in its very beginning, Sushruta has described the character of an ideal student, the character of a teacher also. So these all, the teacher should look, you see, how the student should be. And a certain kind of a behavior, the professional behavior. So they are quite important before selecting. So according to Sushruta, the teacher should be resolved, you see, the memory, good speech, peace of mind, this awareness, they should be differentiated from the coexist, these qualities. Similarly, in Charak also, they also expanded that Vaidya should be healthy, modest, patience should be there, truthfulness, skillful, and fearless. He should have a steady hand, disciplined mind, and not to be boosted with knowledge. These are some of the necessary characters of a physician or a Vaidya. So I with Sushruta Samhita prescribed dress code for a teacher, for a waiter. In detail, the internal characters and external build of a student to be admitted in medical student, as a medical student. The admission process was very strict. The medical student was expected to be honest, humble, temperate, generous, and hardworking. He was not supposed to be enamored with women and engaged in gambling or hunting. His memory and academic performance should be very important. If you look to chapter depicted by Sushruta, what we call Sushruta Upanaya, where the induction of a student in medical education is there. Jivaka said that medical training for a period of 7 years of time, you see, Jivaka has rotated. And rotation to different department, different areas of medicine was compulsory on those days. Students were expected to memorize the classical text and their commentaries. The practical training was an important part of Ayurvedic study. Watching their teacher, curing their illness, and aiding them in preparation of drugs resulting in a lot of learning. Apart from their surgical training, Sushruta advised to practice surgical procedures on various yogya is a chapter I will come, you see, subsequently, that how how to improve your learning ability, you see, by doing working on a simulation. Anatomical knowledge, Sushruta was the first that he realized that to understand the human body and its structure, the structural anatomy is quite important, and he was the first to advise the human cadaver dissection to understanding of Rachana Sarir and Kriya Sarir. So that was his basic contribution. He described how to dissect, you see, human body in a specific manner. Charak also suggested the learning how to identify herbs and their application in preparation of various medications. After finishing medical education, the students to improve upon should continue his skill and understanding. In present day, but these are some of the things what we can see in our ancient times. Now the present day teaching and learning methods, we have a more different kind of, you see, teaching learning methods what we have. But there are a lot of similarities are there. If you compare these things, you see. Nowadays we come across with more a structured learning method. We have a prescribed syllabus. And this syllabus we need to, where we have a given time and given weightage to every point, you see, what we are going to talk to our students. These are done by these steps. We do a lecture, we provide a tutorial, we conduct seminars, symposia, workshop, we give an opportunity to self-study. These, in addition to this, the student also go for a practical training. They go to clinics, you see. That may be a bedside clinics, maybe OPDs, maybe surgical clinics, so on and so on. Then there are simulations coming, you see, what is this, you see, role play, video, and concept map. These are some of the modern way of, but it is all not that there are modern, you see. These are all available on those days, except few. A video and a digital more way of teaching and learning was not there on those days. But there are many are there, you see. They are in our ancient India. We will gradually talk and discuss all these things. See, it depends on it, the number of people to whom we are delivering. If there is a very large number of audience, see, we can go for a lecture, we can go for a panel discussion, symposia. So we will come up one after one, what these terms meaning basically. If there is a very small, relatively smaller group, then you can go for a group discussion, go for a seminar, we go for a workshop, we go for a bedside clinic, demonstration, field visit, and tutorial. But they individually, see, they do themselves by self-study, counseling, the project work, and assignment, you see, work task assignment. So these are the different, some of the ways by which number of persons, people can be communicated. Now, the most common way of communicating the subject matter is by providing a lecture. The lecture is a teaching procedure consists of classification, clarification, or explanation of facts, principles, or lessons. This is a word, which a French word, you see, which means the reading process. It's an oral presentation intended to present, inform, or to teach people about a particular subject. That's what we are doing right now. So you can communicate to a great large number of people. Now we earlier we used to learn, you see, whenever in our own, during our time, it is a chalk and talk. I mean, there is a board, there is a teacher, and there is a chalk. Chalk and dust, these are the means through which our teachers used to take classes, and they used to communicate us. So, the important aspect that in a lecture, there is a master or there is a teacher, and there are students. Remember one thing, talking is not teaching, listening is not. that is very important. So the question is that how much the student can assimilate from you, that is probably the more important. How you can make the things clarity to a student, how it can reach to a student, that is more important. It is not simply I'm talking, that I'm teaching. No. Therefore, see, normally if you see a classroom, it looks like this. You see, teacher is teaching to a blackboard, writing something, and the students, they're sitting on the behind. They talk to each other, or they wrote something, sometimes it's a paper. Like this, what you can see, it is very classical. So why it happens, you see, because the teacher wish to think that he's pumping some knowledge from a high pressure to a lower pressure. But that probably, rather if we make an attitude change, you see, how we can help my students to learn during my lecture, that is probably more important. See, use concrete example to illustrate the abstract principle, that is probably more important. Give a handout of the lecture slides with a space to write notes. Give a handout with particularly completed diagrams and list of students to complete during and after lecture. Allow for a pause in the delivery to give students to write something on the note. Check for understanding. You need to check the understanding by asking queries or questions during the period of your lecture. Whether the students really can, they are getting it or not. In this, I will recall some of my own experiences during this presentation. Professor Thakral is here. I am sure Professor Thakral can recall that he got a class note, you see, what you call a handouts given by the Department of Pharmacology in our higher education. Department of Pharmacology used to provide a handouts to all the students, you see, for every lecture they provided. And at the end of this kind of a thing, I have seen in Calcutta, these handouts are ultimately, they are usually on those days, it was cyclostyle. There was no other form. Cyclostyle machine, most of you have not seen today. It's a, initially it was printed on a paper, and then there was a special machine on which the papers were rolled out on the machine, and then it get impression on the paper, you see, and so quickly they can, just like a photocopy, they come out. So that kind of a printing material, teaching material, we used to get with a very small amount of money providing to the department. And I have seen when I was in Calcutta, these notes are binded together and we call them 10 teachers note. And these are the actual we never buy a textbook, you see, because they are very costly on those days. So we used to buy these hand notes given by the teachers. And they are so nice, you see, and so precious to the point that very effective for examination and as well as understanding. Therefore, they help us to teaching, you see, in their lecture, so that you can, I could recall some of the qualities of a teacher. They used to, therefore a successful teacher is no longer at a height, pumping knowledge at a higher pressure into the students, you see. The teacher must have a behavior. He's just like a senior student, anxious to help his junior. Very famous, you see, lines by William Oscar. So you need not to behave as a boss, you see, rather than a very big knowledgeable person. Of course, he is a knowledgeable person, but rather a more friend to your students. The communication by a lecture, see, it should be lively. Every word has a meaning, you see, lecture. It should be educative. Should give some information. Creative, thought-provoking. One should understand what you are talking. Relevant to the subject, the context, what you are talking, one must enjoy it. That is more important. I know there are a lot of teachers, you see, they become monotonous. So you never realize, you never enjoy to go to the class. I have seen there are teachers, we never miss their classes because we really enjoy their classes. We need to mean it that what they are teaching, they come to our hearts. So that is probably more important. While delivering a lecture, we need to outline the purpose of the lecture, describe the main theme that will be covered, outline and explain the first key point, illustrate with examples. These are some of the ways. Outline and explain the secondary key points, illustrate with examples, and at the end we need to summarize. I need to recall some of my own days when I was in my undergraduate at Calcutta. I was fortunate enough to have some excellent teacher in my career. I have never seen such a beautiful teacher in my life. Especially I recall in these 2 days, Guru Purnima, I do not know whether they are still alive or not. These teachers are teachers in medical colleges. They used to teach us anatomy and they used to teach us pathology. We used to go for teaching. Dr. Kallikinkar Banerjee, one such, who used to teach pathology to us. I have never seen him, you see, that was a half a minute late in his class. He was at the right time. And once he come to the class, he don't see any student. He used to teach very simply, with a very simple words, repeatedly the same things and a very precious things. And after 15 or 20 minutes class or a 30 minute class, he summarized again the whole thing. Every student, even the poorest form of a student, can able to take a note of his class. We never missed to take off his class. The language was so simple. We could understand even though we are not from English speaking or English medium school. We could realize, we could understand, we could read, we could write, you see, all his thoughts, whatever he provide, or a lecture, what he provide. And we have never asked a second question that, sir, ye hame samajh mein nahi aaya. So next class, whenever he come, he again first revise the last class and then he start again in a new topic or a new part of this lesson. Today I don't know whether he, because he is a teacher on those days, maybe in my age time now 40 years has passed, more than 40 years I have passed, you see. So we do not know whether he is still alive or not. Wherever he is, I might pay my best regard to him as a great teacher. I have seen another teacher, you see, was a teacher in anatomy. He was a teacher teaching us anatomy in Arjikar Medical College. I have seen none of my teacher having such excellent skill in teaching anatomy. He used to draw diagram in two hands, you see, both the hands simultaneously. In one hand, he used to draw a diagram, the other hand used to level the diagram with the color chalks. That was the thing. And such a beautiful diagram, you see. One can really understand from his diagram the half of the things. A very few things is required. So such an excellent skill they have, you see, to communicate to their students. So delivering a lecture, see, we need to take care of a few things. The speaker audience distance. We have a lot of distance today, but due to this technology, see, we can see each other. We can share the screen of each other. We can communicate each other. But the body language has a different meaning. It has an impact. It goes to your heart. If you see the face of a teacher, the eyes, the body language, it makes a lot of difference. That what you say, that your facial expression, the clarity of voice, the rate of speech, as I already told you, that the variety of languages you use, the same word can be taught by different languages so that you can understand it. The pause between words, the pause between sentences, the pause between two things, they are quite important. Of course, pronunciation. Many teachers I have seen, they come through the class after chewing betel, half of the things you may not be able to listen. So that is probably not required in it. So we need to be clear voice. Whatever you are trying to communicate, must be able to communicate. I will still say some few more my own experiences. In some of my lectures, I have learned from my teachers. I have seen very none of the institutions, except in some departments at Banaras University, where teaching class is a different way, especially in the department of anatomy. I have seen at the anatomy classes were at the 8 o'clock morning. So we used to go there at 8 o'clock early morning, and what we found that the head of the department, the Sardarji, on those days, he was the director also, and a very senior man with his entire team, a professor, maybe some two professors are there. We are not knowing who is a senior professor or that. There are professors, there are readers, and there are lecturers. There are demonstrators. All together, they used to sit to taking while they take class. See, in an undergraduate class, we are there as a postgraduate first year. All demonstrator of the department were there. All lecturer are there. All readers were there, and head of the departments were there. And a task was given, maybe to a lecturer, maybe to a demonstrator to teach. But everybody sit there and listen carefully. And at the end, they get an opportunity to interact with the student. And if a senior has to add something, they add very gently without hurting the junior. So they gave an opportunity to how to teach, to develop teaching and learning of the junior. And even at times we have seen a junior school teacher teach much effectively than a senior. The language, the communication skill, because they prepare themselves and they talk to the student. Therefore, it is not only teaching a student, it is also to prepare a teacher, also done by doing this kind of exercise. So I feel that while nowadays hardly we have an opportunity to sit together, this is not only in one department. I have seen there are many other departments where they work together. You see, Professor Thakral can recall also in the department of radiology also. So at a morning 8 o'clock, it was in non-clinical department. If you go to the clinical department, morning at 8 o'clock, all the residents, all the teachers together, they sit together, read in each and every X-ray, and they discuss, and they write reporting on the plates or ultrasounds or MRI or whatever it is there. It makes a lot of sense, because when we sit together, there are many mistakes are eliminated. The students, they realize, they learn. This is a process of learning, which requires everybody's attention. It's not in single attention. Altogether, we can do better. This concept probably was unique in my university where I did my study. The advantage of delivering a lecture, it's a factual information useful for a large gathering. It's cost effective. You can go for a large number of people. Quick and straightforward way. Useful methods for auditory learning, easier to create, familiar method, it's a time. These are the advantages of it. The disadvantage, on a particular area, you can talk for a small one-sided affair. Usually teachers, they teach. Hardly you have an opportunity to interact with it. Need proficient oral skill. If you do not communicate orally effectively, you cannot communicate. That is probably one important. The audience, they are passive. They don't interact much. So that is the feedback from the students, that is not much. How to improve upon it? fit the lecture to the audience, focus to your topic, prepare an outline that includes major points, organize your points very clarity, repeat the points when necessary, be aware of your audience, notice their feedback, and be enthusiastic. These are some of the things what we need. Well, you see, we need to evaluate, you see, that what really we are doing, you see, with the students, how they are really learning. While after the class, read, see if you get an opportunity, you see the notes of a student, you see, maybe randomize, ask for a verbal feedback from individual student, ask the student to complete an evaluation, you see, questionnaire, you can put some question, maybe some small question. That is very important. Ask a colleague to observe part or full of the lecture and provide a feedback afterward. For example, it's the clarity, logicality, flow, so on, you see. Now there are a lot of things. You can record your lecture and you can see yourself and you can improve upon it. See, the deliberating on common topic between two, see, now we will talk about discussion. So discussion is a, what we till learn, it's a one-way process lecture. But as a discussion is a deliberating on a common topic by two or more than two persons on a specific object to achieve some specific conclusion or result. Discussion involves two-way communication between participants. In a classroom situation, and instruction and the trainees all participate in discussion. During the discussion, instructors spend some time to listen while the trainees spend some time to talking. It's an effective method of learning, emphasizing students' experience, development of critical thinking, participation by everybody. It's a get an opportunity to express himself or herself. This is a learning in one of the most direct benefit resulting from the. So these are some of the way of, you see, this discussion. You can discuss it subject and you can learn, achieve something very specific. As I told to you that this blackboard teaching now, chalk and board is consuming, time taking, and now of course it's a effective method, but it's less attractive than the PPT. Now we have a communicate much better by doing a take some arranging PPTs, PowerPoint presentation, which is more attractive, where you can add videos, you can clips, you can images, so that become more attractive. So this digital method of teaching, this PowerPoint presentation, video clips, this virtual situation, I'm coming gradually, you see, the digital library. They are also quite important, you see, nowadays for giving any presentation, you see, and talk in a form. Now we also learn, you see, that seminar is another way by which, you see, we communicate. What this basically means is, seminar are simply a group of people coming together for discussion and learning of a specific technique or a topic. The word is derived from a Latin word, which means a seed plot, to root, something very specific to discuss, to root it. Within one department, usually we carry out, as in our department in higher education, you see, every department, they carry their routine seminars. Maybe there's a timetable seminars every day or every week or once a week or twice a week. So what we do, you see, according to their need, a small group of people, and it lasts for 1 to 2 hours. Focus on a particular issue. A topic is given to a candidate or to a student on which he talks, collect information, share, and place, you see, honest feedback. What you can get a feedback from this, your colleagues, your friends, or from the audience, you see, because the group is small among themselves, you see, so you can get. These are some of the way that we carry out in seminars in higher education. The topic is initially presented by a presenter followed by a group discussion. The leader usually within they limit the people so that the focus can be cannot be they should not be diverted from their focus. A care should be taken to avoid stereotypes. The same thing should not be repeated. The seminar techniques were organized the following: there is the organizer, there is the chairman, there are participants, and there are observers. What you can see every day, most of the time in our higher education system, the advantage of seminar usually stimulates thinking because there are someone collect things and you can think on a particular area. Tolerance to say the views of view to develop. Cooperation with others to develop. You need a cooperation to develop then opinions of ideas to occur. So replace none of the behaviors. It gives great instructional value. The natural way of learning represents the norms of behavior. That is, seminars cannot be organized on every continent, and this is not suitable for a smaller area. I mean, lower education. For under many a times for undergraduate education, it may be good for a postgraduate education level of education. Seminar is a time-consuming process and limited to a particular focus. It cannot be applied to new students. They should be familiar to these things. So we also learn by panel discussion. Panel discussion is a it's opportunity to a group of students to listen to several knowledgeable scholars on a particular subject. So there are, you can see there are people, you see, who are expert in the subject, and there is a person who moderate this. I mean, the moderator usually raise questions, they limit themselves. There is a rule, you see, in panel discussion. Every people given equal opportunity to discuss. The time frame is there. The questions are already framed many a times. Many a times, the audience are being asked to put questions, and the moderator, they used to moderate this question and ask to individual, to any of these panelists to reply there, so that the students or people can learn or obtain knowledge from these people. So this is again a relatively smaller group usually. We do it in the panel. Then we also organize periodical workshops. Workshops are generally smaller than conference, and they are usually for a day one day program usually dedicated maybe sometime a training to a particular technique, maybe particular area of discussion, like a hands-on training. It's dedicated to discussing a specific topic. We also invite outside visitors to attend them, maybe as a instructor or maybe as a faculty person, so that we can communicate. The workshop is similar to a seminar, but with a greater degree of attendance and participation. Okay, seminars somebody goes sitting there going nobody bothers, but workshop everybody get there together and they develop skill. And hands-on exercise, you see, that what you call that we go for a hands-on training. So your face-to-face contact is there. You can communicate each other. You can point out things. So there is a greater opportunity of learning. But the difficulty is this in a workshop, they are more, you see, activity-based, engaged in participating, doing those high productivity. That's right. That is very important. A workshop where you learn things. Information sharing, there is a limited number. The disadvantage is that they are very limited number. Then the advantage is that find your talents. You see. So this enhance your skill and you can help others. These are the basic advantages of workshop. You can show your talent, you can enhance your skill, you can help others. If you know things, you can communicate others, you can enhance yourself. So these are the advantages of that. We also organize periodical symposiums. Symposiums seem to be similar to a conference, but a smaller number. They are really somehow a kind of close things, you see, but have a bit of a difference, you see. The symposium is a smaller group, than a conference. Symposium tends to be similar to a conference but smaller. It is also one of the teaching on higher learning. Symposia consists of a set-up program prepared, speeches followed by audience discussion. That's what we call it. You invite people, those who are specialized in their field, and they give their talk, and at the end, you discuss. Symposium is a technique in which two or more persons under the direction of the chairman present several speeches, which gives several aspects of one question. This was first symposium was used by tutor, means a good dialogue, see, to present the view towards the God. And the, another meaning of this is the intellectual reactions, you see, or enjoyment. This is recently we use this terminology, the symposium, with a person to discuss a problem. The main purpose of symposium is to provide understanding to the students or a listener on a problem specific to develop certain values. The conferences, what is really, which is going on everywhere nowadays, conferences tend to be the most prestigious form of an event because they are quite large events. There have been regional conferences, there have been national conferences, there have been global or international conferences according to the participation of different people. Are tends to be the most prestigious form of the event. We wish to get opportunity to present our work as a talk or as a poster presentation and as very smaller workshop and seminar than a smaller workshop and seminar. Conferences usually involves a number of talks, prominent speaker in the field or a poster session where the researchers present their ideas and data in a visual form. Large conferences may have many segments, and means there are many
are you audible?
Yeah, let me communicate. Yeah, I'm audible to all of you. So there are a few more slides there to complete my talk, you see. I'll just
sure sir,
and nearly to complete there are some that something what you are realizing that you are just working like in a real environment, you see. See, for example, if you see that we need many technical or practical training which cannot be done on human while learning. That we can do in real sense by using a similar kind of a thing like intubation. You cannot teach to your student how to intubate on a live human. And a student may not be very perfect to intubate on a live person when it is required on a patient. Therefore, the student need to learn it, and he learn it on a mannequin or a structure which is close to the human, similar to a feeling. The structure, the anatomy is like this. Therefore, like you can do a colonoscopy. We practice colonoscopy by using a training model. You see, where there are the instrument is passed through the different. The instrument is passed for the different structure of different anatomical area of colon, and that you can see that the angulation, the resistance, the things what you need in case of a passing the colonoscope, you can see it on a monitor. That you realize. If you look, you see in our own text, you see Sushruta has given an enormous example. You see, to do that kind of practical training, what you call yoga in our system of medicine, where he has explained very nicely and given example, you see, to create a kind of a simulation, you see, like doing a practical demonstration, you see, by for doing ashta with the shastra karma, agni karma, bandhan karma, then vasti karma also. I mean, these are the most important precious technique which has been done, and you can go through all in very detail, you see, as we all know very well, you see, as a teacher, this Chedan Karma to be done, some of the fruits and vegetables, Vedan Karma should be done on a vessels, you see, filled up with mud and like a vasti, lekhan on skin, animal skin, like on so on and so on, you see, you can go all these things. So they have given example on those days, these are the things which are available to for them. But you can see that there is a close similarity on these simulations and yoga practice training, what they have done on those days. This, there are more newer trained, you see, in learning education. The problem-based training, case-based learning, and integrated teaching. It was sometime 1986, assisting with Professor Deshpande ji. See, he was such a brilliant teacher. I recall, you see, today in Guru Purnima, you see. It was a time when, while performing cholecystectomy, at occasion, cystic duct get injured and there is a bleeding usually. So, and it happens at times, you see, with every surgeon. Sometimes, if he is doing cholecystectomy, some or other time there will be the cystic duct or a accessory branch of cystic duct. By mistake, you may not be able to see it and you can cut it and then you see that there is a bleeding. So, I was pointing out, sir, that there is cystic duct. Sir, usko bandha nahi gaya hai, usko. So, he was insisting me to cut the cystic duct along with that. I was confused. I don't know why my teacher is asking me to cut it. So, then he forced me to cut it. I cut that cystic duct, and at the same time, the artery which was running on the cystic duct. So, moment I cut it, there is a bleeding. So, I was really nervous that I did a great mistake and I cut it. But my teacher was quite calm, and I was not aware at that time. Then, subsequently, I learned that how to control bleeding and understand the chi, that hydrodynamics of swimming means. So, when you swim, you see, if you push your hand on water, that you give some pressure on the water, and then the water, you see, then you move forward. So, that's what amount of pressure will take you to what amount of distance to move forward. So, that's a kind of a dynamics, you see. One can understand very well, we explain, you see. So, you must have an adequate theoretical knowledge at the same time. So last slide, which I am going to share with you, it's a pyramid of learning in which you can see that if you give a lecture, usually the average retention is 5%, reading 10%, audio visual 20%, demonstration 30%. So now discussion, group discussion, it is around 50%. Now practice by doing 75%. Most important, must have an ability to teach others. You can demonstrate to others. If you are able to learn other people, make them learn. You see, that is probably the best way of learning, teaching. You see, if you wish to learn something, as a teacher, you see, I have learned things from many areas. So many people are teacher in my life. You see, I have learned how to do bandaging from my dresser. There was a dresser in our ward, was a quite old man. May not have a theoretical background or anything, but he's an excellent man. If you do a bandaging, it will never open. We used to bandage this scrotal because as a student, we got a lot of patients for operating on hiatuses and hernias. So scrotal support was must use on those days for doing a scrotal bandage. We do a bandage and it usually get loose and the bandage remain, you see, useless. So, but whenever we see that the the dresser do it, it was remained quite steady for a long time. So I learned the bandaging of scrotal bandaging from him. So effectively used to do. So anybody can be. I have learned it from my teacher, that Dr. Dhanikar, who wrote a commentary on Sushrut Samhita also. So on a farewell, when the student asked him to say something so that they can be blessed, you see, he said that he has blessed the entire period of time in 3 years or 4 years of his staying in the university system. If they have could not learn anything in 3 years of time, what they can learn in one or 2 minutes of blessings. Happy Guru Purnima to all of you. And my all sincere respect that all of you will be a moral teachers to the students. Thank you very much for giving me